Immortal, invisible, God, only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. Most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days, Almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Unresting, unhasting, and silent as night, nor wanting, nor wasting, thou rulest in might. Thy justice like mountains high soaring above, thy clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. To all life thou givest, to both great and small, in all life thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish as leaves on the tree, and wither and perish, but naught changes thee. Great Father of glory, pure Father of light, thine angels adore thee, all veiling their sight. Oh Lord, we would render, oh help us to see, 'tis only the splendor of
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon Him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as His people, let us then take refuge in the infinite mercy of God our Heavenly Father, seeking His grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church, in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enlighten our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. How great are your works, O Lord! Your thoughts are very deep. To declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness by night. For you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work. At the works of your hands I sing for joy. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. How great are your works, O Lord! Your thoughts are very deep. Lord, have mercy. Christ, Lord, have mercy. To God on high be glory and peace to all the earth, goodwill from God in heaven, proclaimed at Jesus' birth.
We praise and bless you, Father, your holy name be saved. Our God,
To you, O soul begotten, the Father's Son, we pray. O Lamb of God, our Savior, you take our sins away. For you alone are holy, you only are the Lord, forever and forever be worshipped and adored. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, from whom all good proceeds, grant to us, your humble servants, your holy inspiration, that we may set our minds on the things that are right, and by your merciful guiding accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. The Old Testament lesson for this Sunday is recorded by the Holy Spirit through the prophet Ezekiel, the 33rd chapter. So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning for me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is written by St. Paul in his letter to Rome, the 13th chapter. Paul writes, let every person be subject to the governing authorities. There is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For the same reason, you also pay taxes, for the authorities are ministers of God attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise. Alleluia, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 18th chapter. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And calling to him a child, he put him in the midst of them and said, truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and to be drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe to the world for temptations to sin. For it is necessary that temptations come, but woe to the one by whom the temptation comes. If your hand or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. Throw it away. It's better for you to enter life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet to be thrown into the eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out, throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into the hell of fire. See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. For the Son of Man came to save the lost. So what do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 in the mountains and go in search of the one that went astray? And if he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over the 99 that never went astray. So it is not the will of my Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. So if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen, even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. This is the gospel of our Lord. We confess our faith in the Creed of Nicaea. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We join in the hymn, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Please be seated. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven, to his feet your tribute bring. Ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven, evermore his praises sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the everlasting King. Praise him for his grace and favor to his people in distress. Praise him still the same as ever, slow to chide and swift to bless. Hallelujah, hallelujah, glorious in his faithfulness. Father, like he tends and spares us, well, our feeble frame he knows. In his hand he gently bears us, rescues us from all our foes. Hallelujah, hallelujah, wisely yet his mercy flows. Angels help us to adore him. Please rise. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our risen and ascended Lord Jesus Christ. I read again this portion of the gospel lesson today from Matthew chapter 18. At that time the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And calling to him a child, he put him in the midst of them and said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." This is God's word. Please be seated. I have to say, Pastor Burns must be taller than I am. This thing is very high here. I can hardly see over the top of it. I should have a box or something like that, but we'll do the best we can do. I think it does actually go down a little bit here, but I won't fool around with it now. In Jesus' blessed name. Some of you may remember the heavyweight boxer Muhammad Ali, or Cassius Clay as he was originally named. He would cry out, "I am the greatest," as he danced around the ring and trash-talked his opponents. Of course, sadly, he paid a big price for his years in the ring, as you know. He was actually a pretty nice fella, but his professional career, he was a little bit arrogant, I would say. Muhammad Ali was not the only one who believed that greatness means having power and authority over others. This is the way the world in which we live thinks. Whether it's an athletic team, a government official, or simply relationships among people, even in marriages. As one of our hymns puts it, the world seeks to be praised and honored by the mighty, yet never once reflects they are frail and flighty. Jesus' own disciples had a lot to learn about greatness, especially greatness in God's kingdom. They had a worldly understanding of what it means to be great. They often argued with each other who would be first in the kingdom, who would sit at Jesus' right hand, so on and so forth. That's suggested by the question they ask our Lord one day, "Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" as they all jockeyed for position. I think all of us want to be great, that is, recognized for who we are and what we've done in our lives. There's nothing wrong with trying to be great at what you do, working hard in school so you make good grades, you get a good scholarship, or you work hard in your job to get a good raise or promotion. But this is very dangerous spiritually, and it often spills over into our understanding of our relationship with God, doesn't it? In this morning's gospel lesson, Jesus talks about being great. His idea of greatness in God's kingdom conflicts completely with the world's understanding of what it means to be great. He puts before his disciples as an example, not a strong athlete, not a powerful king, not a general, not an intellectual giant. I think he shocked them when he took a little child and put the little boy on his lap, boy, we don't know that. It might have been a little girl, which in that culture would have shocked them even more, because girls often didn't have many rights among Jews at that time. So we'll say it was a little girl. And he put her on his lap and said, unless you turn and become like children, and pointed this little girl, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And I can just see the shock on their faces. The hymn we just sang reminds us that we are supposed to praise the King of creation, not ourselves. Praise my soul, the King of heaven. To his feet your tribute bring. Some of us live in a childish way, though, in this country. And so today I'd like to ask the question based on this text, am I childish in the way I think and live, or am I childlike? So why don't you ask that question of yourself? I don't care how old you are. Are you a childish person, or are you childlike? So what does it mean to think and live in a childish way? Well, you probably know. Those who are childish think always of themselves. They want everybody else to recognize how great they are. Worse, they believe that they are self-sufficient. They feel no need for God's grace and forgiveness. And often their plea for forgiveness is just so many words. Scripture warns, thus says the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom, let not the mighty man boast in his might, and let not the rich man boast in his riches. But that's exactly what most people around us in this society do. Now, while this kind of self-confidence may be necessary to be a good athlete or a good student or do a good job in your work, it is dangerous when it spills over into our attitude spiritually. And we forget that we are mortal, as the hymn reminds us that we just sang. Well, our feeble frame he knows. Well, our feeble frame he knows. And if this COVID thing has done anything to us, it ought to be reminding us how fragile is life, at least when we get older. How quickly life can change. A few months ago, the United States was booming. And now we're trying to recover again. People have lost their jobs. Restaurants are closed. My own son lost his job. One hymn puts it like this, our powers are frail, from dust we are made. We may flourish like the flowers, but even so we fade. The wind but through us passes, and all our bloom is o'er. We wither like the grasses. Our place knows us no more. I just retired a couple years ago, and I have to say, when you turn 50, 60, 70, I'm not quite at 80 yet, but you start to see how true that hymn is. I just had a full knee replacement about 5 months ago. I guess that due to my 30 years of jogging, that's over. I can't run anymore. I can walk, but I just cannot do the things I used to do. The threads up here get kind of loose, too. I can't always remember people's names like I used to. It's just the way it is. And I'm sure you've felt the same thing. The psalmist cries out, as for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field, but the wind passes over and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. God promises us, though, that even to your old age, I am he. To your gray hairs, I will carry you. I have made you. I will bear you. I will carry you. I will save you. Do you believe that? Or as you get older, do you whine and complain because you can't do what you used to do and people have forgotten all the great things you accomplished in your life? Those who think and live in a childish way like this do not help or even notice others around them who need their help and compassion, since their concern is only about their own greatness. So I'd like to ask you, we see a lot of childish thinking in our culture today. Do you see any of that in your own life? Do you even notice people around you who need what you have? I'm not talking about money. Yeah, that helps too. But I'm talking about simple things like a kind word, a smile, pat on the back. Well, you can't do that these days. I do it anyway. But perhaps you don't even notice that. And I have to say, in my own mind, I don't often notice either. Gosh, yesterday I was driving to Maple Grove, stopped at a stop sign. There was a lady with three kids, a beggar. What did I do? I drove right by. That's what I did. Well, I justified it, you know, because who knows who she is? Maybe she's just a scam artist. We know that happens. But I didn't give her anything. What would you have done? Do you live in the confidence of your need for God's grace and forgiveness? Martin Luther said we are supposed to get up every morning and make the sign of the Holy Cross and say, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Now, whether you make the cross or not, your business. My wife doesn't. I do. So that's an adiaphoron, we say in big words. That means it's not commanded or forbidden. But one thing is important, Luther is saying. Get up in the morning and begin your day with your baptism. Do you do that? Or do you live in the confidence that, oh, I'll just do fine. You don't even think about it. And do you go to bed at night, as Luther says also, in the evening, make the sign of the Holy Cross and say, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit? Or do you just go to sleep, not remembering how critical it is that you are one of God's baptized children, that His powerful name has been put on you? And did you come to church today hungering and thirsting for the body and blood of your Lord Jesus, realizing that you need what the early church fathers called the medicine of immortality, that we should live and not die? Or you take the Lord's Supper for granted, and often, as many in my congregation would do, look at your watch and say, well, that's going to add another 10 minutes on the church service. Or maybe some who would rather get a pizza than have the body of Christ. Today, Jesus is issuing a severe warning to anyone who lives in a childish way. And I'm afraid all of us are probably guilty. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world for temptations to sin. It is necessary that temptations come, but woe to the one by whom they come. And then he has this very exaggerated warning. We call it hyperbole in English. Hyperbole means an exaggeration to make a point more clear. Like my dad used to say when I was a little, young man, you do that again, I'll thrash you within an inch of your life. Now, I knew he wasn't going to do that, but it got the point across. Jesus says, if your hand or your foot cause you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It's better for you to enter a life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet be thrown into eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, rip it out and throw it away. It's better for you to enter a life with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into the hell of fire. Hyperbole, but the warning is clear. So I'm going to ask you again. Have you been living and thinking in a childish way? Getting upset when people don't notice who you are? Don't appreciate what you do. Don't give you a thank you when you went out of your way to do something nice for them. We so often take our Lord's word and sacraments for granted. Do you pray for your pastor, Pastor Burns? What a great gift you have in this congregation. I get around in the Synod a lot. I serve on the board for a national mission of the Synod. I can't tell you how many people come up to me and wish they had a good pastor, one who preached law and gospel to them, one who was faithful in his ministry. You've had many good pastors. I've been here for many years. I knew Pastor Hexel. I knew Pastor Tyler very well. What a great pastor he was. And Pastor Burns, a great pastor. You take care of him. You pray for him. You thank him for his work. Probably there is room for all of us to do what Jesus tells all of us to do today, turn, that is, repent. He wants all of us to be thinking in a childlike way, not a childish way. Listen to what Paul writes in his letter to Corinth. Brothers, do not be childish in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking, be mature. And in his letter to the Ephesians, he urged God's people, let us no longer be little children, tossed to and fro by the waves and carried around by every wind of doctrine, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. So I'm going to ask you, what does it mean to live in a childlike way? To understand this, we must not look to the media or to the world around us for ideas of what it means to be great. We look to the only one who was great as God wants us all to be, to God's eternal child, his eternal son. As St. Paul writes, Christ did not count equality with God to be a thing to be grasped like we do. We hang on to our greatness, but he made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross, a humiliating, shameful way to die. Now that is true greatness as God views it, to serve the needs of others, even as our Lord Jesus served our needs. And not just ours, but the needs of the whole world, even those who don't appreciate it, even those who curse our Lord Jesus and use his name in vain, even for them. He humbled himself to the point of death. As Jesus said, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom, not for a few, but for many. And today, I hope you're awake. That same magnificent Son of God comes to each of us this morning right up here to serve us in a humble way, hiding his majesty and his glory in a little piece of bread, and a little sip of wine, even as he once hid his glory in that little baby lying in the manger. And that baby did not symbolize God. That baby was God. And this bread and wine you will eat and drink in a few moments up here does not symbolize the body and blood of our glorious Lord Jesus. It is really, truly, essentially his body and blood. And he comes to cloak his majesty and his greatness to serve you and me. So those who are childlike in their understanding admit their need for and their absolute dependence on God's grace for life itself. Like all little children, I have a new granddaughter, and my daughter-in-law is nursing her, and that little baby, she starts to cry. And when my daughter-in-law starts to nurse that baby, she calms down. She knows where her nourishment comes from. She can't express it verbally yet or cognitively yet, but she knows that she needs her mother's milk or she'll die. We are baptizing a little girl following this servant, Rosella Ray. And that little infant did not call me up asking for an appointment to be baptized. She will probably squirm around while I baptize her. She may even cry and scream. She may sleep through the whole thing. I don't know. But she is a child in need of God's grace and forgiveness like all of us. And if we are like little children, which Jesus says we should be, we will hunger and thirst for God's grace and forgiveness, especially as it comes to us like today in his Holy Supper. I come, O Savior, to thy table. For weak and weary is my soul. Thou bread of life alone are able to satisfy and make me whole. O Lord, may thy body and thy blood be for my soul the highest good. And then we are to imitate our Lord Jesus. As St. Paul urges us to do, again in his letter to the Ephesians, be imitators of God as beloved children. Have this mind in yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who took the form of a slave. Those who are childlike will then follow the example of our Lord Jesus and humbly serve those, look for those around them who are in need of a kind word, a compliment, a thank you, whatever it may be. Whoever would be great among you, Jesus says, must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be your slave. Even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many, a ransom for you. Whoever you are, whatever you've done, he has paid your debt, you are free. This means we should be doing nothing to offend weak Christians. And by the word that offend, word offend doesn't mean to do something that kind of upsets somebody. The Greek word here means to do something that causes someone to fall away from the Christian faith. The word was actually used among the secular Greeks of a trigger and a trap. And it was called the skandalon, the offense. And when the animal tripped the trigger, the trap sprung. And that's what Jesus says. Don't do something that will serve as a skandalon that will trigger someone to fall from the faith. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and be drowned in the depths of the sea. And if we are thinking as Jesus thinks, we will take the initiative to be reconciled with those who have caused offense. And by God, I know there are many times people offend us in the other sense. They upset us. They don't thank us. They take advantage of us. And what's the first reaction? To get angry? To say, I'll never give that person another thank you or gift? What does Jesus say? If your brother sins against you, and it happens all the time, if your brother sins against you, go and tell everybody what he did. Is that what Jesus says? That's what we do. If your brother sins again, you go and tell him his fault just between you and him alone. And what's the goal and purpose? If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. You have gained your brother. Like the story Jesus tells today, if a man has 100 sheep and one of them strays away, well, that's not so big a deal. You've got 99, don't you? Let the one little stupid lamb go. No, the good shepherd leaves the 99 behind, irresponsible like that might be, to go find that one lost one. And that's what Jesus wants us to do too, to go after that one little lost person, that one who may not be worth our attention, our thanks, and go after them, especially when they sin against us. So I want to ask you again, how are you living? How do you think? In a childish way or in a childlike way? Today we pray, and I pray for myself, and I hope you pray for yourselves, that God might turn all of us from the arrogance of this world around us to Jesus, God's only Son, who though he was rich, emptied himself and became a slave for you and for me, who comes to us once again this morning, hiding his majesty under those humble forms of bread and wine, to serve you with his marvelous salvation, the forgiveness of all your sins, and victory over your death, and the certain promise of a new life to come in the glories of heaven. For after all, aren't we just strangers here? Isn't heaven our real home? For his sake, God assures us that as a tender father has pity on his children here, God in his arms will gather all who are his in childlike fear. God grant it for Jesus' sake, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We join in the prayers of the day. Please rise. Following this petition, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, you respond, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Blessed Lord, you have promised that where two or three are gathered in your name, you are in the midst of them. Hear the prayers of your people. Grant us all our supplications. O Lord, grant your people courage, that with boldness we may speak your name in witness and warn sinners, so that they may come to faith and repentance and enjoy with us the forgiveness of their sins. Give your church wisdom and strength by your Spirit, that she may be steadfast and immovable in your word and truth. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, be present among your people to serve us with the gifts of your grace. Grant that we may always receive them with great joy. Give to us faithful pastors and church workers who will minister to us in your name and strengthen our faith and life together as your baptized people. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, give to us good and honest leaders who will govern according to your word and will. Give us grace that we may never fail to pray for those who lead us and to act as good citizens and good neighbors to one another. Grant peace to the nations and bring an end to all violence, prejudice, and racism. Guide us to know and respect all life, from the infant and unborn in the womb to the youth beginning maturity, and from the mature to the aged, Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you send rain on the earth and turn the seeds into plants rich with fruit for harvest. Accept our thanks and praise for your continued goodness in providing a good harvest and food for all. Give us wisdom that we may use your resources and wisely and extend your care to those in need, Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you urge us to give special care and guidance to the young and those new in the faith. Give us grace that we may never lead them into temptation or sin, but guard their faith by making known to them the full counsel of your word, Lord, in your mercy. And gracious Lord, you are the strength of the weak, the healing of the sick, the comfort of those who grieve, and the peace of those near death. Hear us on behalf of Gary Kruzel, who is now in home hospice. Comfort him and grant him the hope of a new life to come in heaven. We pray for Kirk Rick, Dennis Walter, Jim Forstein, Rick Shavel, Paula Schmidt, Sharon Wilkin, Ada Fields, Debbie Hanna, Judy Erickson, Doug Steer, Melissa Lee, and those named in our hearts. May they be sustained in their afflictions, comforted in life and death, and delivered to eternal life, Lord, in your mercy. And, O Lord, we thank you that Rosella May will become your child this morning in the waters of holy baptism. Guide her and her family as she is nurtured in the faith, Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you have given the day for work and the night for rest. Bless all honest labor and industry, artists and artisans, and those in caring professions. Keep us in true humility. Guard us against pride and arrogance. Give to us the spirit of generosity that we may share with others the blessings that flow from our labors. Lord, in your mercy. And, O Lord, teach us to forgive others as you have forgiven us, and bless the fellowship of the forgiven, that we may be united in doctrine and life. Bless us as we commune today on the true body and blood of our risen Jesus Savior. Help us to live and keep in holy lives, that what we will receive upon our lips we will show forth in our lives in this holy sacrament. Lord, in your mercy. And, O Lord, deliver us from pandemic and pestilence, disaster and danger, from sudden death, that kept in the faith we may be preserved through this mortal life, and in death be received in the arms of your mercy into the blessed rest of everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy. Hear us then, O Lord, who cry to you in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, whom with the Spirit you are one God and one Lord, now and forever. We continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we thank you for your boundless love shown us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him all our sin, giving him into death, that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we now laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of Sabaoth adored, heaven and earth with full acclaim shout the glory of your name. Sing Hosanna in the highest, sing Hosanna to the Lord. Truly blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed are you, O Lord, our God, King of all creation. You have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. In your righteous judgment, you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We thank you for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of his cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. And hear us now as we pray in his name and as he has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me." In the same way also then he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it also to them and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it to remember me." And the peace of our Lord be with you always. You take this sin. O Jesus Christ, true Lamb of God, have mercy on us, Lord, we pray. O Jesus Christ, true Lamb of God, you take the sin. Have mercy on us, Jesus Christ, and grant us peace, O Lord, we pray. You may be seated. Take and eat here the true body of our Lord given into death for you. And drink here our Lord's precious blood shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. And go in his peace. Body of Christ our Lord given for you.
Satisfy the hungry heart with gifts of kindness.
True body of our risen Lord Jesus given for you.
Come to us, so saving Lord, the bread of life to eat.
This is the true body of Christ Jesus our Lord given for you.
Your presence, Lord.
This is the true body of Christ our Lord given for you. This is the body of Christ our Lord given for you. True body of Christ our Lord given for you. This is the true body of our risen Lord Jesus given for you. True body of Christ Jesus our Lord given for you. true body of Christ, our Lord, given for you. True body of Christ, our Lord, given for you. True body of Christ, our Lord, given for you. This is the true body of Christ given for you. This is the true body of Christ, Jesus our Lord, given for you. True body of Christ, our Lord, given for you. Body of Christ, our Lord, given for you. Is that it? Then we'll put this back in and I'll dismiss them. Put this back, then I'll dismiss them. May this true body and blood of our risen Lord Jesus Christ keep you in the Christian faith and bring you finally to the great heavenly feast. Go then in his peace. We rise from the nunc dimittis. Now, lettest thou thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace once again in the sacrament. We ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated. Allow me to make just a quick comment before I leave. I always tell congregations when I preach now, it's good to have a guest minister occasionally because then you appreciate your own pastor more. You're glad when he comes back, so everything's done the way you're used to. But it's wonderful to be with you again. I used to preach here off and on during Lenten round robins we used to do. Some of you may remember that. I always enjoyed coming over here to St. Paul's, and I know St. John's out there, way out west out there, enjoyed Pastor Tyler when he would come out to preach to us, too. So, very happy to be with you. Are there any announcements that need to be made? I urge you again, be sensitive, first of all, to your need for God's grace and forgiveness. Not one day goes by where you don't live by his grace and forgiveness. Isn't that right? And there are people around you who need it from you. And may you not only notice them, but then also reach out to them. Even a simple thing like a smile or a kind word goes a long way. God bless all of you. And I don't know, am I supposed to not greet people out there? It's so hot. I'll just greet you here and wish you God's blessings and God's peace. Go in his grace, and God go with you.